Welcome back to Mbakwa Phosphate Academy. We are looking at chemistry today. Yes, and you can always contact us at 6799531 85, mbakwaphosphate@gmail.com. Facebook page is Mbakwa Phosphate Academy. Last class we look at matter, and you can recall that we did explain that matter is anything that occupies space and has mass. So we can always know the space that is occupied by matter. That space is called volume, and we can of course know the mass of matter by using the balance, the scale balance. So we say that matter can be described by both its physical and chemical properties. And we explained last class that the physical properties include hardness, texture, color, and the rest. Remember our last lesson? We saw the solid, the liquid, the gaseous state of matter. And we did explain that matter can exist in three states. We have solid, liquid, and the gaseous state of matter. And we also explained that it's possible to have the solid state of matter going to the liquid state and equally going to the gaseous state. And we say that, of course, I've just explained that the matter that makes up the universe is made of three states. You have the solid, the liquid, and the gaseous state. In our last class, we saw the properties of solid, liquid, and the gaseous state of matter. That is the solid state of matter. And of course, we say that in the solid state, we will have a definite shape, a definite volume. And we say in the solid state, matter will be incompressible. And we saw some examples of substances in the solid state, which include charcoal, ice, iron, aluminum, yellowstone, and salt. In the liquid state, we saw that liquid do not have a definite shape. They will equally just flew to take the shape of the containing vessel. Liquid have a definite volume. You see, this solid is liquid and this is a gaseous state of matter. We cannot compress liquid. An example of liquid we saw last class that water, kerosene, petrol, and mercury, they are all liquid. We cannot compress liquid. You see the picture on the board. That's the gaseous gas, example of gas. You see that in the gaseous state, matter do not have a definite shape, no definite volume, and they always occupy any container or container in which they are put. Gases are compressible. That's what we saw last class. You can compress a gas like a balloon. You can see a balloon here can be compressed. That's what we had last class. Today we'll be looking at the simple kinetic theory. That's the lesson for today. The simple kinetic theory of matter. What does it state? The simple kinetic theory of matter states that the particles that make up matter are in constant random colliding with each other. Constant random motion, and they collide with each other. They collide with each other. Constant, they are in constant random motion, colliding with each other. Can you see the picture on the board? In the solid state, you see the particles are actually in contact to each other. The particles in the solid state, they can only vibrate at their mean position, at their fixed position. In the liquid state, the particles are a bit further apart from each other. In the gaseous state, the particles we see are 4 days apart, and that's a picture of the gas. The arrangement of particles in the solid state is orderly, the particle in the liquid state and in the gaseous state. If I want to move from solid liquid to gas, you see that there will be increase in the kinetic energy of the particles. You see there is also increase in distance between the particles of matter as we move from solid to gas. So according to this theory, the kinetic theory of matter, the particles in the solid state are held by a very strong force of attraction. So they only vibrate or rotate in a fixed position. So as a solid, we see that as a solid, the solid is going to have a definite shape, definite volume, and cannot be compressible, not compressed. These are examples of the solid. You can see that the solid here has a definite shape. Look at the arrangement of solid. They have a definite shape. We can describe a solid either as rectangular, maybe it's in the form of a cube. You can see that in the liquid state, the particles are further apart, and of course, no force of attraction in the gaseous state, so that helps the particle to be further apart. So in the liquid state, the particles are held by weak forces of attraction, and some movement is permitted. So we say that in the liquid state, the particles can slide over each other. The particles slide over each other, and they are going to assume the shape of the containing vessel in which they are put in. If the vessel in which they are put in, excuse me, is in this shape, it is going to take the shape of this container. This is water in the liquid. In this container, this water is liquid. So this water in the liquid state will take the shape of this container. The water molecules themselves are allowed to move freely over each other. But that does not happen in the solid state. The wall behind me is a solid. The particles here do not move. They do not move. The rising part here is a solid. The particle here can only vibrate about their mean position. They vibrate about their mean position. So consequently, liquid will have a definite volume and indefinite shape. The forces holding the particle in the liquid are very strong enough to prevent compression. So the liquid do not compress. Remember our last lesson. But the particles in the liquid, because of the forces, that the force of attraction in the liquid holding the liquid molecules together, the particles in the liquid are weaker than those in the solid. So the force of attraction here is weaker as compared to the solid. But the particles in the liquid state can only move over each other. Unlike in the solid state, particles are not moving over each other, but they can vibrate about their mean position. They can vibrate about their mean position. I will say that the shape of the solid is fixed and the solid is incompressible, but the shape of the liquid is not fixed. The liquid is going to take the shape of the containing vessel in which it is put in it. So in the gaseous state, the attraction between the particle is negligible or very little. So the gaseous particles are loosely held and consequently very free to move. So you see in the gaseous state, the particles, if I have a gas at one end of the class here, in the office here, you observe that the gas very soon can reach the other end. Why? Because the forces of attraction holding the gas molecules, they have very little or no force of attraction between them. This will help us now to see that the gas molecules are able to be easily compressed. They will have no definite shape or volume. So, excuse me, the gases will not have definite volume or definite shape. that they can, you know, occupy the available volume in which they are putting. Quickly, we want to look at physical and chemical changes. What is a physical change? What is a chemical change? At the end of this lesson, you are going to know what a physical change is and what a chemical change is. Wow. Look at a physical change of water into ice. If you take water in a container and you know, you take the water into a fridge or a freezer, what happens to the water? The water is going to freeze into ice. And here we have ice. Ice, you can hold ice, it's very cold, but you can touch ice. What happens if you take this water back from the fridge outside under the sun? You observe that the ice is going to melt. The ice will melt back into the water liquid. That is what we are going to have. This is an example of a physical change. Now look at what we call a chemical change of hydrogen peroxide into water. Hydrogen peroxide can be converted into water. This process, you cannot bring back this process. I want you to note something here. You have seen that the process of taking water into ice and then taking ice back to water, the process is easily reversible. This process is easily reversible. But if you take hydrogen peroxide to water, this process cannot be reversible. Is an irreversible. It's an irreversible process. So we see that one change is easily reversible and the other change is not easily reversible. What then is a physical change? A physical change is a change that is easily reversible. Can you say with me, easily reversible? It's easily reversible. For example, if you have ice, this is ice. It's very easy for us to move ice through the process of melting to water. And you know that the water molecules themselves are going to be close together, but the water molecules themselves are able to move over each other. Is it possible to take my water back to ice? Answer is yes. The process is solidification. Solidification or freezing. What have you observed? This process is reversible. And therefore we can say that this is an example of a physical change. What happens when we eat water? You observe that you are going to have gas. They are going to have the gaseous form. Or what you call steam. Or what you call the gas state of matter. So water in the liquid state can be converted into the water in the steam form or in the gaseous state through the process we call evaporation. well, that is gators or steam can go back in the water liquid. Imagine me eating water in a closed container and in a transparent vessel. You observe that after some time, if this is your pot, you have your pot here, and this is water here that you have steamed the water, heat the water, you apply heat here, you observe that after some time, the water molecules here will evaporate into steam that will be blocked by this lid, the lid of your pot. That explains the reason why you take, carry this lid, you do not turn it on your face, because there will be water here, water vapor, of course. Now the water vapor, imagine that you allow the lid of this pot still closed, not open. You observe that what, and you remove this heat. You remove this heat, you see that after some time the steam here will begin to drop back. This process is called condensation. The process is called condensation, or what we call liquefaction. Gas is changing to liquid. What you call liquefaction. Now a big question comes, is it possible to take ice directly into steam? Is it possible to take ice directly into steam or any other solid that can change directly from solid to gas? The answer is a big yes. You can take substances like ammonium chloride, dry ice, yes, you can take iodine, you can take your camphor, directly from solid to gas. Imagine putting camphor in the box of your dresses. When you come back and, you know, just open the box of the dress, you are going to get the scent of the camphor, but you are not going to see any liquid where you put the camphor. It means that the camphor changes state directly from solid to gas. This process is called sublimation. It's called sublimation. And now, the gas can also move back into the solid. This process is called deposition. The process is called deposition. What is a chemical change? You see that a physical change is easily reversible, and no new substance or substances are formed for a physical change. The change is easily reversible, and no new substance or substances are formed. And you see that all the change of state of matter are physical. What is a chemical change? One term to describe a chemical change: permanent. The change is permanent. In other words, not easily reversible. The change is permanent, not easily reversible. Then what kind of change is this? What kind of change is this? Can you imagine burning a firewood? When you burn a firewood, it burns into wood ash and charcoal. Can you get back the wood ash, the firewood from the wood ash and charcoal? No. And you have your firewood here, and you burn it. into charcoal. You cannot get back this firewood. Back from charcoal or wood ash. So we see that this process is not easily reversible, and we see that this charcoal that is formed is a new substance. So any process that is not easily reversible and in which a new substance or substances are formed is called a chemical change in chemistry. Fermentation of palm wine is a chemical change. Now can you see this? This is iron. Now, the iron atom will have a chemical change as pyroxed. It will expose iron into air so that this iron will react. The iron react with oxygen to form iron 3 oxide and the presence of water vapor in the atmosphere, we are going to have rust. And this is the formula of rust. Iron 3 oxide with some amount of water. You know this when you are going to be doing the mole concept. That is rust. So this rust, iron, you cannot convert it back to this original iron. This process is not easily reversible, and a new substance, you can see it, is formed. We want to see physical and chemical changes taking place simultaneously. Where can we see this? Here we are. The burning of the candle takes place. The two processes take place here. When you burn the wick, the candle wick. Burning of this candle wick is a chemical process. Burning of the candle wick is a chemical process. The small wick in the candle, this one that is burning, is called a chemical change. But the melting of the wax, all this is the candle wax. All this like this. This is the candle wax. The melting of the candle wax is a chemical change. It's a chemical change. No, sorry. Melting of the candle wax is not a chemical change, is a physical change. Is a physical change. If you melt the candle wax and you take it back to the company that produces this candle, they can get back the wax and then melt it again with high heat and form another candle from it. So melting of candle wax is a physical process, it's called a physical change, but the burning of the candle wick is a chemical process. So this is a process where physical and chemical changes are taking place simultaneously. Assignment, I will want you to, in a tabular form, give me 4 differences between a physical change and a chemical change. Thank you. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel, Bakwa Phosphate Academy.